Hey everybody, I'm Tristan, Shaun, Gregson, back at Grand Prix Portland, here with Gerry Thompson. We're going to talk Scars of Mirrodin previews. Vents or the Sojourner, what do you think?
Probably overhyped. It doesn't seem that good. Like, unless there's specifically some things that are good to blink, it seems really hard to get its loyalty up there, and then you need some stuff to protect it, and it doesn't really protect itself. So.
This is so weird, you're such a bandwagon guy. Like, the fact that you would go against it.
No, see, I like the other two, though. That's the thing.
All right.
So you started off with
we could just move on real fast. Anything else you want to say about this guy?
No.
Let's talk about the good, then. Elspeth Tyrrell.
It seems sweet. Worse than the old Elspeth, probably, because it, you know, costs five, but still pretty good.
Does it do anything you like? Does it do anything you don't like? Like, what more do you want from this card?
I mean, making three guys is pretty sweet, and then just reusable Wrath, you know? I mean, it's awesome.
Reusable? You're playing a hell of a control deck. You make this card.
No, we go late. We go real late.
Get in there with a lot of guys, eventually.
Yeah. All right.
Lastly, the one that everyone's talking about right now, Koth the Hammer.
The Hammer. What time is it? It's hammer time.
You're worse than Luis.
Yeah. He rubs off on everyone, I think, so blame him.
Let's keep it that way.
But that one seems good. I'm not sure if there's like a deck for it right now. Got to see more of the cards. But in something like Legacy, that's the type of card that, you know, people can't really, they're not set up to deal with, you know? Like, if you play like a Dragon Stompy deck, which is, you know, normally not a good deck, but they have like Rakdos Pit Dragon as their threat, and like, that card's hard to deal with sometimes. But, you know, like, this thing instead of that seems awesome. So
you're the first. I'm glad to see you're the first guy that's touched on Legacy for Koth. Everyone's like, red deck lives, like Lava Hound's all the plus side.
Yeah.
Like, finally.
Yeah, I mean, these cards are just so difficult to deal with in the older formats, because it's like they're so dead set on just like, you know, killing a wild in the call or whatever, and then you play like an enchantment, they're like, oh god, how do I beat that thing, you know? Or
you're just alluring them out of the game, right?
Yeah, exactly, something like that. But like Planeswalkers, the same thing, you know. A lot of decks don't have creatures. They can't attack it. So it's like, what are you going to do? You know,
you got to beat down for four every turn, or you're going to dump your hand.
Yeah, exactly.
All right. Gerry, you've made it to the bonus round. What do you think, Mox Opal?
I think the card is awesome.
Ooh.
Martell is the only other person to have that opinion so far.
Really? It seems so weird. Like, all these Metalcraft cards seem so good.
You do know it's legendary, right?
I do know that.
Okay, because he didn't.
Oh,
and then
well,
the conversation kind of spiraled out of control.
Like, oh, no, I actually think the card's still really good. Like, if it's just a complete free roll in Vintage, and Legacy, I'm sure you can design, you know, some decks with that. But, like, if you have Trinket Mage and, you know, a bunch of other stuff like that, card seems real good. Think about that card in, like, Time Sieve in Standard, you know? But there's not a deck like that, but, like, there's going to be, right? There's got to be other artifacts and stuff.
It definitely seems like we're already thinking, like, a year or two out extended.
Yeah, sure. I mean, card's just really powerful.
Finally, somebody who knows it's legendary can say that.
Yeah, I'm down. I'll definitely be playing with that card.
Excellent,
and not just in draft. See, it seems good in draft.
Yeah, of course. I played Chromox in draft.
Yeah, I was talking to Luis about this. Did you just overdraft the Affinity archetype?
Yes. Yeah, like no one else knew what they were doing, so it's so easy to beat them with, like, you know, 2 mana 4/5 Vigilance guys. Like Quicksilver Behemoth, for those of you who don't know.
But it's okay. I got wrecked by that card once.
Yeah. Well, that card, like, it's just the best card ever. No one knew how to draft, so they're not, you know, you just table artifact lands and stuff like that, and it's just, for some
spell
reason,
bombs were amazing.
Like, yeah, yeah.
Somber Hover Guard, such a high pick.
Towards the end of the format is sweet, because, like, the off-color mirrors were better than the on-color ones and stuff like that. You know, it's things like that that people don't notice. So stuff like Quicksilver Behemoth, even though it's, like, 7 mana, you know, like, it's literally the best common in that set. So
now, looking at what you've seen from Scars right now, do you think that the limited format is going to be anything close to original Mirrodin?
It's hard to say. There haven't been, like, a lot of vanilla creatures spoiled. So, like, now it seems kind of like how I would draft my Mirrodin decks, where it's, like, I don't have a lot of, like, 2-mana 2-2s or 3-mana whatevers. Like, it's, I have a bunch of, like, mirror mind servants and cards that are just, like, not really good on their own, but very synergetic. And if everything is, like, going towards Metalcraft and stuff like that, then that's going to be the same thing. But
if you try to make comparisons, and you try to say Metalcraft is like Affinity, if you've already got 5-mana mirrors, 6-mana mirrors, 7-mana mirrors, whatever, you've got Bone Splitters uncommon, like you're kind of seeing some of the similar things. There's a lot of cats that make more cats. That's kind of an original thing.
Sure.
Mirrodin.
Yeah, like the white and green decks were the only ones that they looked like a normal draft deck. Everything else, like if you draft, like, black-red, you still kind of have an artifact theme. If you're blue, you definitely have this weird artifact theme. But, I mean, it doesn't seem like there are that many normal cards, you know what I mean? They all kind of, like, function off each other and stuff like that. So, I mean, hopefully that's how it is, because I would rather be able to draft, like, a synergetic deck and be paid off for stuff like that rather than just like, oh, best white card in the pack, right, best green card, you know.
Thoughtcast equivalent is going to go up and down in pick order,
yeah,
depending on
exactly,
how they...
Exactly. Yeah. It's like someone is going to windmill slam that thing fifth pick when they would have first picked it, and the other guys in front of them, like, they just don't want it anywhere near their deck, you know. Stuff moves way up and way down. So.
Excellent. Well, you got some pro-level events to play with that set, and like for, like, Ben Stark keeps talking about how much he loves Mirrodin, and you're right there.
Yeah.
And Luis.
That format was my first Grand Prix Top 8, and I did pretty well in the Pro Tour in that format, and I was, like, 10-0 in another Grand Prix in that format. I love that format. Drafted it all the time. That was, like, the first thing that I learned where I was really good. So, I mean, hopefully this is similar.
Hopefully it won't give you scars. I'm trying to be like Luis now, too. All right.
I'll take them.
Thank you. All right. Thanks for watching.